in the difference between Bitcoin and Monero, that brings up some other, you know, I'm not a Bitcoin maximalist. I'm not against Bitcoin, but I do think that, you know, Bitcoin has some flaws that I think a lot of the maximalists overlook long term. I mean, specifically, I think there's always this cope of, well, Bitcoin has issues. You know, let's say, you know, it's, maybe mining is too centralized. Maybe there are all these extreme transaction fees. You know, if I want to send you $5 on the Bitcoin network right now, if I try and send it, I'll have to pay $10 or $15 in fees. It's obscene, right? So there's no such thing as using Bitcoin for an actual, you know, medium of exchange. It really is just, and that's why you have maximalists out there. What do they say that Bitcoin does? Well, they just say it's a store of value, right? You put money in it and forget about it. And I think, you know, one thing that I think people need to think about who make that kind of argument is the fact that you can add layer two onto Bitcoin. You can have the Lightning Network. You can have, you know, to take an extreme example, you know, someone like Michael Saylor will even say things like Coinbase or Kraken. These are layer two on top of Bitcoin, and that's a good thing. And the issue with that is, you know, if you look at human history, okay, let's look at gold, okay? Bitcoin is digital gold, right? Well, Bitcoin will probably follow the exact same thing that happened to gold, in that gold was originally used as a store of value, but it's a terrible currency for the similar reasons, actually, that Bitcoin is. It's hard to transact with. Gold is also hard to divide. It's hard to transport. So, you know, what people did is they invented a layer two for gold, and that's called paper currency. You know, you went into the market in Venice, and instead of trading gold, you turned in your gold at the bank. They gave you paper notes, and you use those paper notes that are what so much better. Well, we can see what happened with this deficient store of value gold. I mean, well, it's a great store of value, but it's bad currency, gold, in that its layer two eventually took over. People started saying, well, oh, well, let's say in the American Civil War, the government said, oh, well, you know, the gold standard is very constraining. We're going to temporarily not redeem your gold. We're going to throw some more money in there to stimulate the economy. Oh, it's no problem. We'll go back on the gold standard later. And they did. But what eventually happens is the layer two phenomena overtakes the core of it. And that to me is the problem with Bitcoin. Bitcoin is not a usable, it's not fungible, it's not private, it doesn't have, you know, transaction fees are totally unworkable. So what ends up happening is that the layer two takes over what Bitcoin is supposed to do. And that's the issue. We'll be back at square one, you know, if Bitcoin actually takes over. Which I don't think it will anyway, because it's so unusable. Like, you'll never have businesses out there actually just requiring Bitcoin. You know, I don't think that'll ever happen. We said a lot of people have misunderstandings about Bitcoin. They just assume that it's private or something. They assume all these things about it. But you actually learn a lot more about Bitcoin when you look into something like Monero and you realize, oh, Monero, you know, has ring signatures and stealth addresses. What does that actually mean? Bitcoin doesn't have this, you know, by definition. And the other thing is, because a lot of people nowadays, they're using layer two, they're buying money on Coinbase or something like that, meaning they're not really using Bitcoin at all. I want people to understand, if you have money on exchanges, you don't have money. Okay. I just want to be clear. That is just you paying a company to pretend that you own this address that you don't really have. And they promise that you'll be able to cash them out, but that's not real. That is not using cryptocurrency the way it's supposed to be used, because you're not really in control of it. And, you know, the thing I said earlier about gold, right, the disaster of gold, you know, leaving the gold standard happened because so many people were using these layer twos. And I think it's very feasible. This is going to sound crazy. I'm going to say it. It's going to sound crazy. But I think there's a high possibility of this happening. You know, if Bitcoin becomes widely used, let's say we have all the big exchanges and they're all sort of regulated by the government. It's very plausible if Bitcoin becomes well used, that the government can step in and say, oh, well, we need to stimulate the Bitcoin economy, so you need to not let people cash out, and we're going to print 2 million Bitcoin. And if it's not on layer one, if it's on layer two, you can do that. You can very easily do that, okay? If you're using centralized exchanges that are just, you know, none of it's real anyway. That is one of the reasons you don't want to do these things. Like, if you're using them, you know, just bear in mind, you're not really using the cryptocurrency that you think you're you're doing. You know, I actually listened to part of the interview you had, I forget the guy's name, right before me. Just, I watched it. I think he was a Bitcoin maxi. But, you know, his, the case.
Oh, Mark Moss. Mark Moss. Okay.
Yeah. So I watched part of that. And the case that he made, and I understand this, is, oh, well, we have to have a dumb base layer, and then you build the good stuff on top of it. And I think that, I mean, I understand that totally. You want a simple base layer, but you want that base layer to do everything that you really need. I mean, just as an example, let's say take something like email, okay? The thing with email is that everyone uses it. Everyone has a, you know, it's part of the internet for good. Everyone has an email account. But the, you know, SMTP protocol is actually terrible because none of it is by default encrypted. Now, there's no reason to ever send an email to someone without it being encrypted. You know what I mean? No one wants to send an email to someone that anyone else can read. So that should be a core functionality of email. But we, you know, and of course you can encrypt an email with like GPG, but that's hard to use. And the metadata isn't, you know, encrypted. There are all these problems because we didn't build that into the base layer. And my contention is, you know, when it comes to a currency, the fungibility of the currency is priority number one, and the privacy of people using it. I think a lot of people will say stuff like, oh, you know, I don't care if people see my transactions. I'm not doing anything illegal, which is, it's an easy thing to say because no one has ever lived in the world where anyone can see your transactions. That is a totally novel thing, right? So we can't even, I mean, I think even Fluffy Pony, right? He's done presentations. Those who don't know, that's one of the lead Monero guys, but he's done presentations quoting statistics saying that something like 10% of people, you know, they're the only ones who actually care about financial transaction privacy. Okay. But the only reason that so few number of people care about that is because they've never had to deal with it. Like if any stalker or, you know, potential burglar could easily read your transaction history and your wallet amount, you would understand very quickly that, you know, Monero, it's not a darknet currency for weirdos. It's a currency that everyone needs. The privacy function fundamentally protects people who are just normal people and want to get around. And currencies just don't work unless they are totally private.